Good morning, my dear students, and a very warm welcome to all of you in this e-learning session. Welcome to Science by Harsha Ma'am. Friends, in our today's session, we are going to continue on the organelles. The very first part that we will do is, we will revise all the content that we have done today, till today. Especially organelles we will revise, and the rest of the things we'll revise in our later sessions. So first, let's start on. We started with which organelle? We started with endoplasmic reticulum. I hope you remember that it was acting like a hallway where the passage of proteins became very easy. The revision is done because it is biology, and in biology it is very much essential that you revise the content. So let's move further. It is like a hallway, as we discussed, because it is a passageway for the proteins to move in and out of the cell, like the hallway is a passage to move in the house. The next thing is important points regarding the endoplasmic reticulum. They are stated over here. They help the movement of any of the substance. Moreover, they are the network of interconnected membranes, and it is a single membrane bound organelle. It is occurring in three forms, that is cisternae, vesicles and tubules. There are how many types? Two types. That is rough endoplasmic reticulum and smooth endoplasmic reticulum. Rough endoplasmic reticulum is denoted as RER, smooth endoplasmic reticulum as SER. Now, why is rough endoplasmic reticulum called as rough? And why is smooth endoplasmic reticulum called as smooth? Rough endoplasmic reticulum is called as rough because it is having ribosomes attached to it. Now, what is the function of ribosome? Function of ribosome is to manufacture the proteins, and it will ultimately modify the proteins. So, this is how there are ribosomes which are attached to the surface, and they will help in the manufacturing of proteins. Moving further, smooth endoplasmic reticulum, it has no ribosomes attached to it. It has enzymes that will help in building up the molecules. It has carbohydrates and lipids. So it will help in, it is helping in the formation of lipids. That is very important point, which will be discussed even over here. So the functions of endoplasmic reticulum are, as we have discussed, that it is the only organelle that can move within the cell, so it is serving as a channel for the transport of the materials. The proteins are formed by RER and the lipids that are formed by SER. Both of them help in the formation of plasma membrane, that is cell membrane, and so this process is called as membrane biogenesis. That means synthesis of the membrane. Also, it helps in the synthesis of fats, steroids, cholesterol. Important point about SER is it will help in the detoxification of drugs and poisonous byproducts. Coming to the next point, that is ribosome. As we discussed, that the processed food which we can eat, it is made in the kitchen in the same way for the cell, it's made in the ribosomes. It is the protein factory. It is made up of basically two things, that is proteins and rRNA. What it will do, it will join the amino acids and it will make the protein so that the protein synthesis will take place. 26 amino acids together, they will club up and they will form a protein, and like that way it goes on. The next particular part which we did was Golgi apparatus. As you can see over here, it is like a closet. In a closet, as we keep everything properly at its place, properly segregated in the same way. Here the Golgi apparatus will work. This one, the Golgi complex. What it will do? Whatever proteins and anything is coming, it will first wind up necessary things, necessary carbohydrates, lipids, it will attach to it, and then it will dispatch it. Okay, it is having two phases, that is cis phase and trans phase, as we have discussed. It is the shipping station. It has two phases, cis phase and transphase. It will receive the proteins that are made by endoplasmic reticulum, and they will transport the vesicles and by modifying it. So this is its main function. It will modify, sort and package the molecules from the endoplasmic reticulum for the storage or for transporting it in the cell. Its functions, if we talk about two very important functions of our GERL girl system, that is Golgi apparatus and endoplasmic reticulum, both help in the formation of lysosomes excuse me. And the second very important point regarding this was it helps in the formation of egg yolk. Rest, all these things are coming under one output, that is it is helping in the packaging. Molecules will first come in the form of the vesicles, they'll fuse with its membrane and they'll get modified by Golgi body. Again, after getting modified, they'll pinched off and they will leave the Golgi apparatus and they will combine with the plasma membrane and they'll send the content out of the cell. Then comes lysosomes. They are suicidal bags, cellular scavengers. These are the basic words which are given to them. Why? Because they contain digestive enzymes. Under any problematic situation, they will burst out and they will release the digestive enzymes. So, they are helpful in the breakdown of food, bacteria, worn out cell organelles, and ultimately they are going to help in the cell renewal. Actually, they are programmed for cell death. That means over here, this word means that, as we have already discussed, that it will burst out itself and ultimately for the cell it will burst out its own self. So it will release the enzyme. That is why it is stated over here. So these are the functions. It helps in the cell renewal and the breakdown of the cell parts. It will digest the invaders, that is the foreign materials which are coming inside. It is, the process is called as autophagy. Auto means self, phagy means eating. Ultimately, it will eat up itself or the worn out materials. It will throw away, and that's the reason it is given these names, cellular scavengers also. Now, this is the diagram of it. Coming to the important part, that is mitochondria. Mitochondria, if we talk about this particular thing, then mitochondria, they are like the electricity mains, as you can see over here. Like the electricity is the thing that is giving the energy for any of the thing so that it can work properly. Any of the appliance can work. The, as you can see, the board, digital board over here is working. We are in the light says he's. All this is because of the electricity. Because some kind of power is given to them and so they are utilizing it. In the same way, mitochondria is like electricity. Because it is giving the energy to the cell, it is giving the power to the cell. And it will, like the electricity is allowing all the functions at home to carry out properly, same way mitochondria is having its work, and so it is called as the powerhouse of the cell. The very important give reason that you are studying since your lower standards. Why is mitochondria called as power of the cell? Because it is helping in the formation of its energy in the form of ATP that you have studied in your lower standards also, 8th class, 8 also. So this is why it is called as powerhouse of the cell. So first note down this, then we will move further. Be quick. Be quick and note it. So, my dear ones, I hope you have already noted this content that is about the mitochondria which we are discussing right now. Now, let us move further on the further part of mitochondria. Before we move further, let's have a look at its structure. As you can see, it is surrounded by a double membrane. It has two membranes. One is the outer membrane and another one is the inner membrane. How many membrane is mitochondria having? Two membrane. Because it is having two membranes are such that outer membrane is fully permeable, but the inner is semi-permeable. That means from the outer membrane, this outer membrane, everything will be allowed to come inside, while from the inner membrane, all things will not be allowed to come inside. Once again, from the outer membrane, everything will be allowed to come inside because it is fully permeable, but inner membrane is selective permeable. It is surrounded by a double membrane. It has its own DNA. This is very, very important point. It has its own DNA, own RNA, and so only it is capable of replicating itself. That means it is semi-autonomous. मतलब कि एक माइटोकॉन्ड्रिया अपने जैसा दूसरा माइटोकॉन्ड्रिया बना सकता है. Because it is having its own DNA, RNA, ribosomes, everything it has of its own. And so one mitochondria can make another mitochondria. So, important point or parameter over here is this. As we discussed over here, it is surrounded by a double membrane where outer is fully permeable. Okay, outer membrane is fully permeable. If it's not visible, I will write it over here. Outer is fully permeable. While inner is selective permeable. It has its own DNA. Because it is having its own DNA, so it is semi-autonomous. Which means that semi-autonomous. Okay, semi-autonomous. Then you can see over here this folds this way, this one. The inner folds are called as cristae. And why are this cristae present? This cristae are present that surface area can be increased. Inside the cristae, there is a fluid over here, which is called as matrix. The fluid over here, what it is called as matrix. Interior is called as mitochondrial matrix or also matrix. That means it is having a fluid, a thick fluid inside it. Further, it has some of the particles inside which are called as oxysomes. what is the functioning of these oxysomes now? This oxysomes, they will help in the formation of ATP. Ultimately, they are going to help out in the formation of the energy. So, energy producing particles are called as oxysomes. Once again, the entire thing, first of all, mitochondria is surrounded by two membranes. Outer membrane is fully permeable, inner membrane is semi-permeable. It has its own DNA. It has fold-like structures, and this fold-like structure is called as cristae. Because it is having its own DNA, it is also called as semi-autonomous. It has the fluid inside it, interior, that is the fluid, jelly-like fluid, dense jelly-like fluid inside it is called matrix or mitochondrial matrix. Okay, and inside it, it is having oxysomes. OXYSOMES. What is the function of these oxysomes? It will help in energy producing. It helps in formation of energy in the form of ATP. Energy in ATP, that is the form in which it is forming the energy. I hope you are clear with the entire part. With this, whatever things are there in the textbook gets completed up, but we are having one or two more things which we will discuss. First, note it down very quickly. So I hope you have noted it. Now, one of the very important and very interesting fact. Whenever fertilization is taking place, at that time, the mitochondria in the fertilized egg is the mitochondria of the egg cell. So, you might be shocked or you might be... this is a very interesting fact which is there over here. That is, you inherit the mitochondria from your mother. Okay, so please note it down. That is, we inherit the mitochondria from our mother. So, these are very important points or parameters regarding the mitochondria. As we discussed that it has, it will help in the breakdown of fuel molecules, that is, it is helping in the cellular respiration and it is forming the energy. So, that is given over here, and it will ultimately help in the breakdown of glucose into fatty acids, and it will release the energy in the form of ATP. It has oxysomes, as we discussed, it has oxysomes which are helping in the particles that are helping in the formation of ATP. They are ATP producing particles and they are semi-autonomous. That means mitochondria will be able to replicate itself, will be able to form another mitochondria like itself. So, whatever we have discussed, its basic important parameters which I had written extra or are noted over here. So, you also note it down. It will be very good for you if you note it. After that, we'll move further. We have already discussed these parts. So, I hope you have noted it. Let's move further on the next part, that is the chloroplast. Before we start on the chloroplast, some of the very important points that we are going to discuss over here. So, as we stated that some of the very important parameters we are going to first discuss. The important parameter which we are going to discuss over here is about the plastid. Now, if we talk about plastids, then these plastids are present only in plant cells. They are present only in plant cells. So, if we talk about the types of plastids, then the plastids are basically of two types. The two types of plastids are chromoplast and leucoplast. So, plastids is of how many types? Two types. The two types are chromoplast and leucoplast. If we talk about chromo, then here both are possible. Either it is green or it is non-green. If it's green, then particularly you have studied about the chloroplast. It contains green pigment which is called as chlorophyll that helps in the formation of energy during the photosynthesis. Non-green can be of different colors. The different colors of flowers, fruits, they are like red, yellow. Their color is imparted by chromoplast non-green, which are containing carotenoids inside it. Now let us move further in the next part of chromoplast, that is chloroplast. Once again, which topic we are doing? We are doing plastids. I hope it's visible now. If we talk about the plastids, then it is present only in plant cells and it is of how many types? Two types. Chromoplast or leucoplast. Chromo includes both green and non-green. Green chloroplast, non-green it can be flower, fruit, different colors. Then that except green and that different colors are because of the presence of that particular pigment and that is chromoplast. Coming in detail about the chloroplast first. This is about the chloroplast. It is helping to capture the energy. Now, have a look at the diagram which is given over here. This diagram is the diagram of chloroplast. In this diagram, you can see over here the stroma. Now, this stroma, it is the fluid, colorless matrix which is present in the chloroplast. So, what is stroma? Stroma, it is colorless matrix that is present in the chloroplast. Okay. Now next, it has folds inside it and that become free. That folds are called as lamellae. So here you are having, it has folds that become free and that folds are called as lamellae. These folds. Folds that become free. So the folds that become free, they are called as lamellae. Next, when the lamellae, they form discoid. Discoid means disc-like structure. This, when the lamellae forms discoid, that is disc-like structure, flat they are and they are like a sack. So when the lamellae forms discoid, flat sack, they are called as thylakoid. So what is thylakoid? It is discoid, flat sack. Disc-like structure, disc circular-like structure, then that is called as thylakoid. And piles of the thylakoid is called as granum. Piles, etle thappi. Once again, there are just four things which you have to remember over here. And at the stroma, dark reactions occur. Now, what is a dark reaction? See, you all might be knowing that even at the night timings, many times you might have seen that it is observed that at night time, don't go under the tree because the reverse process takes place in the trees. There is a scientific reason behind all these things. The reverse process of the tree setting that is taking place even at the night. In absence of the light energy, there are some reactions taking place in the tree. Then that reactions are called as dark reactions and they are occurring at stroma. If we talk about stroma, then what is stroma? It is the colorless ground matrix that is present over here. And further, this folds. These folds are called as lamellae. And when these folds, they form a discoid flat sac like structure, then it is called as thylakoid. And piles of the thylakoid, thylakoid ni thappi, what is that called as? Granum. You are having this particular diagram in your textbook also, but first only note down the name and whatever is written. Only note down the name and even take the screenshot of this so that whenever you revise, it becomes easy for you to memorize the content. Whenever you are revising, it will become easy if you have this with you. hope you have taken the screenshot. Yes, now I think it's visible. Important point over here are also there. Chloroplast have explained you entirely. The dark reaction, as we talked about, it occurs at stroma. If we talk about the plastids, then like mitochondria, they are also semi-autonomous because they have their own DNA. So they are semi-autonomous. This is very important point because they have their own DNA. Note down this. So I hope, my dear students, that you are clear with the entire content. We have done today actually two short notes. One is mitochondria and another one is this, that is plastid. So today's homework. The very first thing is give reason mitochondria is called as powerhouse of cell. Second one, explain about structure of mitochondria. Third, write a note on plastids. Okay, especially the chloroplast you have to explain. Note down your homework very quickly. So I hope you have noted it, and that's all for today. I hope you are clear with the content that has been done over here. Thank you so much for listening to me, and have a very good day. That's all. Next time we'll meet with the last short note, that is vacuoles, and then we'll terminate the lesson. We'll wind up with the lesson. Last part, that is vacuoles, is left out. Thank you so much for listening to me, and have a very good day. That's all. Bye-bye.